Okay, good morning. Let me start the lecture. And only three of you are here. And I have some suggestions set up. And I will be talking about KIT later. Let me start by the PowerPoint. We are going to study the chapter number 8, okay, for this incoming 10 weeks. Time really fast. Now it's 10 weeks already, and we have only 2 more weeks left. The chapter 8, we are talking about the analysis of indeterminate structure. Okay, actually, we're talking about this statically indeterminate structure since chapter 4 and chapter 5 of mechanics of material. If you may go back to review what you have learned. But in short, what we have from the lectures, we consider, for example, the beam, okay? And the beam that we consider is the statically determinate beam. The statically determinate beam is a stable beam. It can be determined by using the free body diagram and the equation of equilibrium. As you may know, we going to have the unknown equal to the number of equation. For example, if we consider this simple beam subjected to the force of 10 kilonewton, this is 1 meter, this is 2 meter. We are going to use the free body diagram in which this one is the pin, is going to have the reaction of A sub X and A sub Y, and this one going to have the reaction of B sub Y, and then the number of unknown equal to the number of equation of equilibrium you can solve for this reaction, okay? And then you also can draw the shear diagram of this one, and you also can draw the moment diagram of this one, in which the shear diagram supposed to have the shape like this, okay? And the moment diagram will have the shape like this. And then we come to the chapter 7 of this subject, or chapter 12 of the mechanics of material. We're talking about the deformation of the structure, okay? Since the load 10 kilonewton close to point A more than the point B, so the slope that occur here is going to be larger than the slope that occur here, and you can draw the elastic curve of this beam similar to this picture, okay? And you also know that at the some point between this mismatch and this loading, there is going to have the maximum deflection, we call it V max. And at this point, we have the slope theta equal to zero. Now, we move to statically indeterminate structure. There is two ways to change the statically determinate structure into statically indeterminate. One, you add, okay, the support into the structure. For example, for this beam, okay, you may add the support into the middle of the beam by doing this. You have the same beam, and this beam has this pin, and this beam has the roller. You may add one more support let's say, at the midspan of this. Okay, so under the application of this 10 kilonewton, what happened is you're going to have the reaction. This one gonna be A sub Y. This one gonna be B sub Y. This one gonna be C sub Y. And this one is A sub X. So the unknown is going to be 4. And then the number of equation of equilibrium still have 3. So this is going to be statically indeterminate structure with the degree of indeterminacy equal to 4 unknown minus 3 equation equal to 1. Okay, you may add the support. Okay, and let's say you also can change the support. And when you change the support, let's say for the same beam, if you just change the pin to the fix, so your beam is going to be something like this, okay? And then when you change this one, this pin change to fix, and this roller change to fix, the structure will subjected to the 10 kilonewton, but this 10 kilonewton at the same point, 1 meter, 2 meter, will produce what? Will produce the reaction that's different from the pin. We are going to have A sub Y. We're going to have A sub X. And since this is fixed, we are going to have M sub A over here. Okay, and this one also, we're going to have B sub Y and B sub X. And this one is going to be M sub B. By this picture, you have 6 unknown. So this structure will have the degree of indeterminacy equal to 6 minus 3. This is going to be 3. So how can we solve this structure? How can we analyze this beam? Okay, we're going to put some more equation into this consideration. And as you may see, under the application of the force, the structure change their shape. For this one, this is going to be fixed. This is going to be fixed. If you just pick up this one, and then when you place at the center, at the 1 meter from the A, the shape, the deflection shape of this one gonna be something like this. So if you sketch this one, the deflection will have the shape something like this. This is going to concave downward, and this one going to concave upward. Okay, and then you going to use this deformation as some spatial equation uses to analyze the beam. Okay, this may be more complex. Just consider this one. Okay, this one is the pin. This is the roller. So the deformation of this gonna be something like this. This is going to concave upward, and then another part of this gonna concave downward like this. Okay, if you prefer, you can have this one and this one, and all of them is the pin and roller, and this is going to be the shape, okay, of this beam, okay, with 1 degree of indeterminacy. And let me just start consider this one. What we are going to put into this, we're going to put the compatibility condition. If you go back to the mechanics of material, you will use to with this one. For this problem, we require only one. For this problem, we require 3 more. So let us start by the simple one. What is going to be the compatibility equation for this one? If you go back and then you use the principle of superposition to consider this superposition to consider this, and you can again draw this picture. This one actually is can be the beam. Okay, have the pin and the roller at A and B, and under the application of this 10 kilonewton, you just said, okay, this beam has this reaction of C sub Y. Okay, now this one and this one is equivalent to each other. By using the principle of superposition, you can separate this beam into two beams. Okay, one is this one, another one is this one. Okay, and they're going to have the same support. This one and this one, and one we call it primary beam or primary structure. The primary structure gonna subjected to the loading of 10 kilonewton, 1 meter, 2 meter as before. Okay, and the other one will subjected to the force of C sub Y. And this one going to be 1.5 meter and this one going to be 1.5 meter. And then you use the same knowledge over here from the chapter number 7, you can analyze the deformation of this structure. Okay, at the same time also, you can analyze the deflection of this structure. Okay, what is the compatibility condition from the chapter 4 and chapter 7, 4 and 5 of mechanics of material, is the condition that we consider the deformation of the structure. And what? This one, we're gonna consider the point C. This one, we're gonna consider the point C. Under the application of this one, this deflection, we will have this one gonna be delta sub C, or this one may say is going to be V sub C Y. Okay, and then over here, we also have this one. Okay, this one is going to be a deformation, but since we don't know C sub Y, okay, C sub Y, so the deformation over here, the deformation over here, it will determine when we assume the C sub Y to be 1.0, and then we can find this one at F, the deflection F at point what? At point C, due to the force applied at point C. And then since this one determine where C sub Y equal to 1, if C sub Y is C sub Y, the deflection here gonna be F sub C, C, C sub Y. Now, we arrive at the compatibility condition at point C. Okay, and then you can see that at point C here is going to be the same thing as over here. Okay, the deformation at point C over here gonna be 0. And then it's gonna be equal to what? It's gonna be equal to this one, delta sub C. Since delta sub C is that one, okay, let's see. This one is gonna be 0 equal to delta sub C. That one is positive, so this one gonna be upward. So this one gonna be equal to minus F sub C, C, and then time C sub Y. This we call the compatibility condition. We consider the compatibility condition from what? From the deformation of the structure at point C. Okay, and then we arrange this one. We will get C sub Y equal to what? Equal to delta sub C. And then it's going to divided by what? Divided by the deflection due to the unit load F sub CC. Now, you will use the knowledge of chapter 7 to determine the delta sub C and F sub CC. So what the knowledge is what? It's knowledge about finding the deflection. You may use the method of double integration, okay? Or using the deflection table, okay? Or you may use the conjugate beam to find it. Or you may use the method of virtual. There is many ways to determine this one. That's why we are going to have the examination on this coming Sunday. You got to be skillful on using the deflection table, on using the double integration, on using the conjugate beam, or on using the virtual. And I will the one who give you what the method you are going to use. Okay, that's the reason why. And then after you get the C sub Y, you will get the value of this. When you get the value of this, you know the value of this. That means the unknown will only A sub X, A sub Y, and B sub Y. Then you can use the equation of equilibrium to solve this problem. Okay? And this is the first thing we are going to talk about. And then another thing is we are going to involve with the frame and also with the task. Okay, so the chapter 8 will involve what is the beam. And then we use the knowledge of the beam to analyze the frame. Okay, and then from the frame we can use is to analyze the task. Okay, we're going to have three types of structure over here. And what the method we are going to use, what I'm saying over here, the method is called the method of consistent deformation. Okay, and also we have another method called method of least work. And I will leave method of least works for you guys to study by yourself, because the time constraint and the method of least work and the method of consistent deformation have very the same concept. Okay, so you may just use only one of this. Okay, and then we have the beam, we have the frame, and we have the task as I mentioned. Okay, and coming into this point, thinking about this model of very large building. Okay, and in the building, again, you will have the thus you will have the beam, and when the beam connected to the column, we call it the frame. And most of the time, the member of this building, okay, they are statically indeterminate structure. Okay, it's a structure that has stability. It won't move under the application of the force and under the application of the loading. And then the total of the unknown reaction and internal forces and moment going to be larger than the total of the equation of equilibrium. Okay, let you guys taking a close look to this structure, and you can classify the task. Where is the beam? Where is the frame? Okay, and this is the picture that you see near model kit in the capstone design project. So next year, all of you will have a chance to do this kind of modeling. Okay, and this is another modeling of the four-story reinforced concrete building. This one has the beam and the column as the reinforced concrete. and the slab is the piece. This is concrete slab, and the roof, the back one on the top of this, is made by the steel. So that's why you guys are supposed to study the material testing, mechanics of material, to know about various kind of construction materials and their property. And also their specification, in order you guys can use this knowledge to do the structural modeling of this kind of structure. And later on, you will study the subject that's called the soil mechanics and foundation design, for you guys to design this kind of footing and piles. Okay, you still have a lot of things to learn. And if you traveling across our SUT campus, there is some construction over here, and some of them are really interesting. For example, if you consider the beam, okay, connected from one column to another column like this, all of them construct and connects continuously. This kind of column, and this is column and beam, when they connect like this, they will behave like a frame. Okay, they work together between the beam and the frame. This is a kind of statically indeterminate. Okay, and also on the top, this is the truss. Okay, and also this one, I show you the cast in place reinforced concrete frame in which the column connect with the beam rigidly connected. Okay, they cast the concrete and connect the beam and connect the column together. Okay, if you just consider this beam, the model of this beam is going to be the same as this one I has show you from the period first slide. And this one, there is the load that's transferred from the floor into the beam. So this first part of the structure, this first part of structure, there is going to be the slab over here. Okay, and then this portion, they're going to subject it to uniformly distributed. And then there is the beam that connect the stair. Okay, so the weight from there gonna transfer to this middle span and as the what? And as the point load. Okay, and the beam also has their own weight. So this portion of the beam also will subjected to their own weight. So the loading on this beam will be complex one. Okay, and then you're going to have this one for A supply, this one for B supply, this one for B sub X, this one for A sub X, this one for M sub A, and this one for M sub B. The unknown is going to be larger than the equation of equilibrium. Okay. And then we will also have the pre-stressed concrete slab in which the slab connect to the column without the beam. Okay, this is a special thing and is very, very popular today in the construction of the building. This slab is called the pre-stressed concrete slab. They use the pre-stressed wire to strengthening the concrete. It is more efficiency, or is more effective than the reinforced concrete. And this show you the steel frame. Okay, this steel frame is up to you. You are the one who model the structure, engineer, model the structure, engineer, models the structure. And then the engineer After model the structure, the engineer also provide the detail, of construction. You got to provide the detail, of construction. So it is your duty, to provide all of this. If this one is fixed support, okay, so the foundation here, supposed to have the piling under it to make this one as the fixed support, okay? Ajahn, if I don't want to have the fixed support, I just want to have the pin support. If you have just pin support, you may put this foundation on the soil as the serpent foundation. So this is your job, okay, to give it. If this is pin, as said, okay, this, when you model it, the foundation will change to this one. And then the beam have what? The beam have rigid joint and connection. You can see the joint over here, they are connected rigidly and reinforced with some special steel over here, okay? So what we have, the structure under the application of the force is maybe the force transfer here from the purlin, into this frame, okay? This may be the gravity load, okay, that's transfer here. And also, you see, on the side of this building, after you putting the metal sheet into the side, this one may transfer the horizontal force into this frame. Under the application of this, you're going to have what? You're going to have the reaction. Okay, if this is pin, you're going to have this one A sub Y, B sub Y, and this one gonna be B sub X, and this one gonna be A sub X again. This is going to be statically indeterminate frame. However, if you change this one into the fixed support, okay, the degree of indeterminacy of this frame gonna be increased. Okay, and when you do the analysis, you are the one who provide the detail of the support, of the connection, of the member, okay, or of everything. That's, you can do it by the engineering graphic, okay? And most of the time we use the AutoCAD to do the job. Or you can use the GetUp, but it's not popular as the AutoCAD. Okay, that is the introduction. And then there is some advantage and disadvantage of the structure. For example, this is what, this is going to be statically determinate because this is pin and this is the roller. Okay, you can analyze this beam based on the engineering static mechanics of material and based on the theory of structure to get the shear diagram, to get the moment diagram, to get the elastic curve. And then we change the support from what? From the pin to the fix, okay? From the roller, to the fix. And then again, as you may know, this is going to be the statically indeterminate with the degree of indeterminacy equal to 3. You're going to study in this chapter and the structural analysis to analyze the statically indeterminate structure to get the shear diagram, to get the moment diagram, and to get the elastic curve. And as you may see, if these two beams subjected to the same load of P and has the same length of L, Okay, you can see two things over here. One is going to be the shear force and the moment diagram. You can see the maximum shear is okay. The maximum shear occur on these two beams are the same, but the moment diagram are different. The moment diagram occur here is PL over 4. The moment diagram occur here is going to be PL over 8 and PL over 8. That mean what? That mean the maximum moment of the statically indeterminate structure is half, for the example, of the statically determinate. That mean what? If you design this beam, the section of the beam gonna be smaller. The section of the beam gonna be smaller, okay? Because this Mmax based on PL over 8 and PL over 4. Or in the other way, if you has the same section of this beam and this beam, when you have the same section, you have the same eye. Okay, and you can see that this beam have the delta max of PLQ over 48 EI. However, this statically indeterminate beam has delta max 4 times less. That means what? If you do the design, just don't care about the deflection. This section, the less section, gonna have a smaller section compared to this green section. Or if you use the same green section, the diffraction of this one gonna be smaller. Okay, so it can say the advantage of statically indeterminate. The first one is use less material in construction. Okay, due to the smaller Mmax. Or the second one, if it has the same section, the statically indeterminate beam gonna have smaller deflection. Okay, and this one can prove easily. I will show you really quick in this model. Okay, and then the stress distribution. Due to this kind of moment diagram, there is the stress distribution occur. Occur from what? Occur from the middle of the beam, of the statically determinate. When you change to indeterminate, the half of PL over 4 will move to this, and half will move to this as the negative moment. So there is the better internal stress distribution onto the statically indeterminate. But the internal stress distribution also have the drawback. Okay, however, you have the drawback because if the structure have the differential settlement, I will mention this later in the disadvantage, they're going to produce the crack, okay, in the structural member. And the third is provide the cantilever construction. Okay, now let me stop over here for a while. This cantilever method is going to be very good practice when you build the bridge across the river, so the boat can still moving, passing under the bridge during the construction. Or if you build the bridge, if this one is the road, okay, the vehicle also can move. This is the advantage of the cantilever construction method. So now, let us just come to this one, and let you guys consider this one. Let me move the challenge into this setup. Okay, this setup. You can see this setup, right? Okay, this is what? This is statically determinate. If you assume this is pin, this is roller, and then this is the midspan of the beam. If you put the load into this beam, what happened is the beam deform, as you can see. And then you also will know that this will produce the reaction. And also this one will produce the reaction. The reaction from this light blue gonna be larger than the reaction due to this red pin, see? And then what? You can store the shear diagram is going to be large at this one, and then it's going to be constant, and then it's going to change from negative to the, from the positive to the negative here. Also, you can analyze the moment. This is going to be the moment diagram, the maximum moment gonna occur here. So you get the Mmax, and then you get the maximum shear. You can decide this speed, okay? And chapter 7 of this theory of structure and chapter 12 will give you the knowledge of what? Of the elastic curve. The slope at this point is going to be larger than the slope at this point. The maximum deflection will occur somewhere over here. You may use the deflection table. You may use the double integration. You may use the conjugate beam. You may use the what? Virtual work to analyze this one. Okay, and you can see under this one, the deflection here is pretty large. You can reduce the deflection of this beam by what? Changing this one. Okay, if you're changing this one from the pin and roller to the fix, just fix it. Okay. Keep this one as stiff as it is by what? By just put your hand into this one. And you can see the deflection reduce a lot. This is the effect of changing the pin to the fix and changing the roller into the fix. We reduce what? We reduce the deflection of this structure. Okay, as I mentioned. And this is the effect of change the support. You may also do another thing. You may just put this one. If the structure in the situation that the beam may be the old one, and then it's may use for 20 years, after 20 years, the deflection here is too large. You like to strengthening it. You like to fix it. Okay, one way is changing the support, okay. Another way is just add that one more support into this beam. Just put one more support here, and then you can see this beam is going to be very stiff. The deflection over here change into this point, and it's reduced a lot. Again, this is statically indeterminate with 1 degree of indeterminacy. The previous one is a statically indeterminate with 3 degree of indeterminacy. Okay, and one more thing, you can see you will use less material in this construction, but you may need to construct the support, and sometimes the cost of the construction of support may be pretty large, so it's changed to be the disadvantage. The same thing like this, you got to put a lot of butt and bow or cast the beam into the support, and you also need to increase the construction cost. But for the strengthening of structure, okay, you're going to get the new strong and stiff structure to soak it, okay? And then coming into the cantilever construction, for example, okay, if you have this, maybe the lever, okay, or this may be the area of the road, that we have the vehicle, okay, travel across this one. You may see this kind of construction in the construction of elevated highway. Okay, or the picture, the last picture in the PowerPoint, you may construct this beam in the other side. Okay, and then you can move. Okay, this one by construct it in this direction. And then you can see underneath it, the boat or the vehicle still can use the area under it. You didn't interrupt the uses of the area under it by this kind of can deliver. But it's require you to have this kind of support here, okay? To make this kind of construction possible, okay? And another disadvantage of the statically indeterminate is the differential settlement. For the structure to be pin and roller, okay, you can move this one without bending any beam because the pin and the roller let you to rotate the structural member. So there is no internal force into this structure. However, when the structure is fixed, for example, let me put this one. This one going to be harder to show you. If the structure is pin, okay, you can move it very simple. But if this one is fixed and then some of the support just have some settlement, you can see now the beam bent. When the beam bent like this, there is internal shear force and internal moment inside it. This is the advantage of this statically indeterminate. Okay, you got to build the foundation really static one with no settlement. Okay, and then also if you add some more support like this, okay, and let's say if this one is the pin, this one and the roller, if this support just move up or move down, if it move up, okay, you can see this one gonna be bent again. There is some stasis in this one. So this is the disadvantage of statically indeterminate due to the differential settlement. Also, there is some disadvantage forward for the temperature change. Okay, if this one is so fixed and if temperature just change, they cannot move because the support fixed. So it's going to bend the structure like this. Okay, it's hot, differential in temperature. So there is some stasis into this. And another thing, when you consider the statically indeterminate is the reverse of the stress. Okay, if this is subjected to the force like this, see, if you don't fix this one, there is nothing happen here. Okay, since this is pin, this is roller, and you can see the structure bent. That means when the load is like this, you're going to land force. See my thumb? You're going to land force the steel here to taking care of the tension. And also, since this one bent up, so the steel will put more over here. However, when the load change to be like this, okay, and then you fix this one, the reinforcement of the steel gonna be in the reverse direction. So you got to put the steel more here and on the top. So when we design the statically indeterminate beam, you got to consider the structure in many cases. From this one, that means you got to reinforce the beam along the length of the beam. Okay, this is what I'm like to show you guys on this model. Okay, let me go back to what the PowerPoint. We finished talking about the advantage of statically indeterminate structure. We also have some kind of disadvantage of this structure. Okay, this is also the cantilever construction. The statically indeterminate structure require a more complex on the design and analysis of the structure. As I mentioned about this, the connection also may be more detailed. Okay, and then when doing that, the cost of the construction also increase, and sometimes it may be more expensive than saving in the material cost that we just mentioned in the advantage number one. And also there are some problem about differential settlement of the foundation, the temperature change, and also in the fabrication error that may cause some large stresses in the structure. Unlike the statically determinate beam show over here and over here, okay, the differential settlement just cause them to move. But anyway, if there is some kind of settlement like this, the function of the beam over here also may lose, and you also need to strengthening kit or need to fix it, need to repair these beams, okay? And this show you the crack occur in our dormitory number 9. This is many years ago, 10 plus years ago, and we need to fix the differential settlement, okay? By using many kind of way. One is going to be, we use what's so called the micro pie. You go to the Google and you just search for this words. Okay, I also putting some knowledge about micro pie in my Facebook group. Okay, this is a way that we can fix the structure. And again, I mentioned about this for many times. We built the structure for many years, and the structure that we built are now old, really old, okay? Some of them more function, okay? So the way to make it to be new, make it more function as before, you may need to fix it, you may need to strengthen it, you may need to rehabilitation it. This is a new kind of work, okay? The last one I just mentioned about this is changing of the load pattern. This one will produce this kind of deflection. This one will produce this kind of deflection. And then the reinforcement that you provide to this beam must be include this kind of situations in our design. Okay. And then coming into what we used to have in the mechanics of material, if we consider this one and or the free body diagram of this one, we have this one as what? Equilibrium of particle A. And then we just set up the reference axis of X and reference axis of Y. Under the 10 kilonewton force, we have what? We have the tension in the cable, and this one will produce F sub AD, and this one also produce F sub AB. And since you know the direction of this one of 4-3, and this one also as 4-3, you can use the engineering static, okay, to solve this one. But coming into this one, okay, this one you have summation of X sub X equal to 0, summation of F sub Y equal to 0. You can solve it. For what? For F sub AB, for F sub AD. But for this one, you have 3 unknown. Okay, you cannot analyze this structure, okay, by only the equation of equilibrium. Again, you're going to use some special thing. That is what you're going to need additional consideration. Okay, one is going to be the compatibility condition that I mentioned it from the previous slide. And what we have from the previous slide, we can determine C sub Y from what? From the delta sub C. and then also from what? From the F sub CC. The delta sub C and F sub CC is going to be the force displacement relationship. Okay, you can use the deflection table to find this. For example, if you come to the beam with this kind of deflection, we mentioned about this before. What we have is what? The deflection here is going to be PL cubed over 48 EI. This is going to be the force and displacement relationship. Okay, it's an example. And there is another thing. I like you guys just go back over here and review it, okay, in the analysis of this. And you can solve for the unknown, okay, over here. And there is two methods. Over here is the displacement method. Okay, we study this one for the mechanics of material. We use the displacement as the unknown, and then we solve for the force. Okay, and another one. This one we are going to use it in this theory of structure. And we didn't teach much about the force method in the mechanics of material. This one we are going to use the force as the unknown. Okay, if you may recall from the previous example, I used the C sub Y, C sub Y, okay, as the extra unknown. And we call this one as the redundant force, okay? Redundant force. This is more than we need, so it's redundant. And then we use this one as redundant force. So, for example, under the application of this P, we are going to have the F sub B here. Also, we are going to have F sub A here. It's only reaction. And then what? We can separate this one, okay, into the one subjected to the given load P. Okay, if you recall from the beam, this is going to be the 10 kilonewton load. Okay, and produce this kind of the deformation. And then the redundant. Now, this one is going to be the redundant force as point B. We call it F sub B. F sub B, what? F sub B will also produce this delta sub B. And what we have from the Leo structure here, we have what? We have the level of this point B is at this line, okay? And then the delta P and delta B must be balanced for the Leo structure. That's called the compatibility condition. This is going to be the reference line of zero. This is going to be the reference line of zero. So the delta P is going to be downward, and this is downward is positive. So the delta sub B is going to be in the opposite direction. So it's going to be negative. And now we are going to use the force displacement relationship. And you know, this is the axial force member. This is going to be the force displacement relationship. You just plug this one back here. You just plug this one back here. And then you can solve for the redundant force. Okay, the F sub B. After you get the F sub B, you come back over here. You draw the free body diagram. And the free body diagram going to provide you the equation of equilibrium in which F sub A plus F sub B, if you summation of F sub Y equal to zero, upward is positive, is going to be equal to P. And then you put F sub B over here. Okay, you can solve. This is going to be F sub B for what? For the F sub A. And this is going to be the force method. And we are going to use this force method in our study in chapter number 8. We are going to use the force as the unknown, and from the first, we are going to write the compatibility equation. Okay, when we use the compatibility equation, we also need to have the force displacement relationship to solve for what? To solve for the unknown force. So most of the time, this is going to be first, consider the structure. Second, we write the compatibility equation. And then third, we consider the force displacement relationship. Then first, we solve for the redundant. Okay, we call this as the redundant. And then for the displacement method, we did study about this a lot in the mechanics of material in chapter 4 and chapter 5. And we again will use this displacement method later in the structural analysis. Okay, in this way, we will use the equation of equilibrium with what? With the force displacement relationship to solve for what? So for the displacement. So by the meantime, let us consider the force method first. Okay, the force method require the knowledge of principle of superposition, because the beam that we consider will have more. This is going to be 10 kilonewton, 1 meter, 2 meter. We'll have more unknown. This is going to be the support than the equation of equilibrium. So we know this is going to be A sub Y, it's going to be A sub X, it's going to be C sub Y, it's going to be B sub Y. We just first consider this one. We use the principle of superposition in our first step. We separate this beam into two of them, okay, by setting up the redundant. Okay, most of the time in the step number one, we going to set the C sub Y as redundant force. Okay, so this is going to be the redundant force. Since this one is the redundant force, the support here and here and here and here still the same. This one subjected to 10 kilonewton. We call this one as the primary structure or the primary beam. Okay, and then again, we put the C sub Y F into this structure. This one gonna be 1.5 meter. This one gonna be 1.5 meter because this one is at the mid span. And this one is 1 meter. This one is 2 meter. Under the application of the force, the structure will deform. Okay, this one will deform like this. And this one will deform like this, as I mentioned before. Now we need to know the knowledge of what? Of chapter 7 from the previous one. And then we have this one as what? This is Poise. This one is going to be V sub C or delta sub C. And also we have this one. Okay, this one is what? This one will determine the FC sub Y, but C sub Y is unknown. We just change C sub Y to 1 and then we determine this one is deflection at point C due to the C sub Y apply at point C. And then since this one comes from the what? The 1.0 force. And actually this one is C sub Y. So this is the total of C sub Y. This is the first step of the analysis of the problem. Okay. And we use the principle of superposition to what? To change the beam into this one for two of them. Okay, and then it's come to the second step. As I just mentioned before, we write down the compatibility condition of what? At what? At C. Okay, this one is zero. Just put a zero and then equal to what? Equal to the delta sub C is now what is positive. And then it's going to have this one for upward is minus C sub Y. And then this one is going to be time with F sub CC. Okay, and then you write down again as before the C sub Y, okay, is going to be the delta sub C and then divided by F sub CC. And then you go to the third step, okay, to what? To use the force and deformation relationship. And this one requires the knowledge of chapter 7, okay, to determine the deflection of the beam, deflection of the thrust, deflection of the frame. And then coming to the next step, okay, that's number 4, you solve forward for the C sub Y equal to what? And then you analyze the structure as you has before. But before we can use the principle of superposition, there is two things, okay? The first one, the structure, the material that's used to build the structure must have the linear elastic behavior under the applied loading. That means what? That means the sigma max must be less than or equal to sigma sub Y in actuality. But in our design, we did put some factor of safety. So don't worry, this assumption always correct. And then as you may know, for this one gonna be equal to PLQ over 48 EI. And then you can see the deflection V and what? And the force P, they are going to have what? Linear relationship. And then you can see the other one also. This one has linear relationship between deflection and the applied loss. Okay. Second one, as you may know, the Vmax that occur on the structure will be less than or equal to V allow. And we also know that V allow may be the L over 240 if there is no wall under the beam. That is going to be very small. Okay, the beam with the span L of 2400 millimeter will have the V allow of only 10 millimeter. If you compare 10 with the 2400, that is going to be very small, okay? And I like you guys to go back to review the chapter 7, especially the deflection table. We may use the deflection table many times to solve the problem. And the problem that I just mentioned, use this table, but there is another problem, okay? We are going to concentrate into this problem. This is going to be the cantilevered beam, okay? This cantilevered beam have what? Have the fixed support and has the free end, okay? The structure, the beam of this can be changed, okay, into the statically indeterminate, even though this is subjected to the load of P. If you just put the roller over here, This beam will change from the cantilever beam, which is statically determinate, change into this one gonna be A sub Y, this one gonna be A sub X, and this one is gonna be M sub A, and you're going to have this one for B sub Y. And most of the time, we will set this B sub Y as the redundant force. Okay, you may put this one as the redundant force, or sometimes you may prefer in the lecture, if you go back, okay, you may select the M sub A. Okay, you may also select the M sub A as the redundant moment. It's depend on what you are going to consider. If you're going to use the B sub Y as the redundant, your problem gonna use the principle of superposition, separate this beam into two cantilever beam. Okay, now one gonna subjected to the load P over here, and another one will subjected to the load B sub Y over here. The one over here will have the deflection in the form like this one, and you will have this one. Okay, you will have this one as the deflection. Okay, and then you also have this one, this one, okay, as your deflection from the second one. This is the curve, and then this is going to be the straight line, and then this is going to involve with this one. However, the load have the opposite direction, but don't worry, okay, you can use this one to determine the deflection over here. This deflection gonna be due to the P equal to 1. This is going to be F sub B. F at point B due to the B sub Y at over here. This is going to be F sub BB, and this is going to have B sub Y. Okay, and at the same point, you may project this one like this. And what? Over here, there is also the deflection over here. This is going to be the V sub C or delta sub C. Okay, you can determine from this equation. Okay, when L, oh sorry, this one not from this, this one from this equation. You just put X, okay, measure from this one to this one. This is going to be X. Let's say this X may be 2 meter, and this is 1 meter. Just put this X to be 2 meter, and L equal to 3 meter. Just put X equal to 3 meter. So you can determine this one is going to be, let's say, 10 kilonewton. And then X is going to be 2 meter divided by 6 EI. And then this is going to be 3 times 3, and then minus 2. This is 9 minus 2 is 7. Okay, 7 is going to be what? It's going to be 7 times this one. This one cut this one into T. This is going to be 70 divided by 3 EI. Okay, it's going to be very easy, see? But for this one also, you can determine it easily by finding the deflection over here. Okay, and this one, you can find F sub BB and put it over here. Now, this is another simple way to solve it, and we will concentrate on these two types. One based on the cantilever beam, another one will be based on this simple beam. Okay, and I ask you guys to practice this, because we don't have much time, and we will focus on the problem with the degree of indeterminacy equal to 1, as I just show you the example. Okay, and this is the example of another statically indeterminate beam. This is the bridge. It has the roller support here. It has the roller support here. It has the roller support here. The beam just continuously connected. And you can see this point, the connection between the beam, very rigid connection. Okay, and then this beam going to be one of the good example of that. Okay, and I did send you the extra example. Now I'd like to demonstrate how to solve the statically indeterminate beam by using some special extra example. There are some examples in the PowerPoint. You can study it by yourself, or also you may watch my video clips, okay, in my YouTube. That's going to explain to you what kind of the example that we have in the PowerPoint. Okay, let me move a little bit to what we have here. Let you guys please bring up your extra example. I like to start with the one that's more similar to your guy. Let me show you which one. Oh, this is going to be harder. This is going to be harder. Okay. Let me start by doing this one. Okay. This is, let me move the chair into this one. Oh, screen sharing. Okay. Today we have only. Okay. There is something wrong here. Let me take this one out, discard it, and then just come into. Okay, this one. Now I connect to this. Okay, coming to this one. This will be the example based on the cantilever beam. Okay, and I also provide you some detail over here. And then after this, I will show you this beam. This is going to be based on the simply supported beam, and we will use this deflection table to solve it. Okay, and later, next example, I will show you this one. This one, we don't have the deflection table, but for this one, you're gonna use the conjugate beam, you're gonna use the virtual work or any kind of method to solve for the deflection equation. So I should start with one that's simple to you guys. Just let me start by doing this. This is going to be statically indeterminate beam. And then what we have here is what? We have here is what? Is the beam with the fixed support. So this one we will have A sub Y. This one we will have A sub X. And this one for sure M sub A. And this one gonna have the B sub Y. So really first step of this start by first we first consider the beam, okay? And by doing this, I will let the B sub Y as the redundant force, okay? Redundant force. And then when you putting this, you got to refer to by using the principle of superposition season. Okay, we have what? We have to separate this beef into two of them. Let me put this one to this one. This one is going to be the primary beef. Okay, this based on what? Based on this one. And this one will plus with another beam with subjected to the force of B sub Y. If you refer to this, you will have our structure that going to subjected to this one. Okay, this one is the cantilever beam. It's subjected to both of 8 kilonewton, and this is 6 kilonewton per meter, and this one is subjected to the force of B sub Y. This is what you supposed to understand it, okay? And then the second, you got to what? You got to set up the compatibility condition, okay? At the compatibility condition, you got to understand the elastic curve of this structure. This is going to be really simple, okay? This is fixed, okay? And then you push it over here. This is the elastic curve of this one. So this is going to be the
elastic curve.
Yes.
We can see your skin.
You cannot see my skin? Oh, yeah. Bad. This is bad. I did share it already, right? I didn't? Okay.
So, I just see only your face.
Sorry, I share the skin. Sorry. Okay, anyway, let me move into this again. Thank you very much. Okay, let me start again. Can you see my skin? You see me, right?
Yeah, okay.
This is going to be the statically indeterminate beam based on what? Based on the cantilever beam. And we have 4 unknowns, okay? And by consider the beam, we will set the B sub Y as our Lyndon force. Why? Why I set B sub Y as the Lyndon force? Because based upon this, is based upon the cantilever beam. Okay, that's why we set the B sub Y as Lyndon. And then by using the principle of superposition, we can draw the cantilever beam. Okay, we separate the first one, the beam that's subjected to 8 kilonewton and 6 kilonewton per meter. And another one, the beam that's subjected to the Lyndon. And then the second one, we're going to what? We're going to set up the compatibility condition. And then we require the knowledge of what? Of the elastic curve. You got to draw the elastic curve. And then this one gonna be fixed. And we supposed to have this one, okay? As the what? The elastic curve of this beam. Okay, all that's gonna be here. And under the application of the force, again, the beam also have the elastic curve. This one is fixed, okay? This one will have this kind of deformation, okay? So you got to the elastic curve. And what we have is we are concentrated on the point B. At the point B, we have what? Okay, under the elastic curve, over here, the deflection under point B under force is gonna be 0. And then it's gonna be equal to what? Deflection over here, which is going to be the downward. And we're going to call this one delta sub B, or anybody may call it V sub BY if you prefer, okay? And this is downward. Let's set the downward. Downward is positive. This is another thing. Okay, and this is delta sub b. And coming into this one, we don't know b sub y. We are going to solve for it. So most of the time, we just set this one to be 1.0. And then the deflection here gonna be f. We just put the symbol of this one by the small f. At what? At point b. When the b sub y apply here. Okay, and then this is gonna time by, this is for 1 unit, okay? If this one is going to produce by the b sub y, just put this one. So this is upward, this is going to be negative, and this is b sub y. And then this one time f sub bb. By doing this, what we have is going to be the compatibility equation. B sub y gonna be equal to delta sub b, and then divided by f sub bb. Okay, now the deflection table going to be important. Which one we are going to use? Okay, we are going to use for the delta sub b. We are going to use this one and this one. Okay, and for the f sub bb, we are going to use this one. The third step, okay. The third step, we're going to find the what so called the force and deflection or displacement, or you may choose this one P delta or PV relationship, okay. This relationship, and this one. Can we use the deflection table, or you can use the conjugate beam, or you may use the virtual. I will the one who assign you. Okay, this one we start by using the deflection table. Okay, and by doing this, we start. By find delta sub b. If you going to find delta sub b gonna form this one. You may have delta sub b. One will form this one. Okay. And then we are going to be what? You going to put this one. By this one, what we have, we got to measure this one for this one. The x is going to be equal to L, okay? Equal to the length of L here. And then what? This one is going to be from 0 to L. So it's going to be really easy. And this one, negative is for what? It's downward. So don't worry. This one is going to be W, okay? And time L squared. And then divided by 24 EI. And then this is going to be L squared minus 4 L squared plus 6 L squared. Okay, if you put everything together, this one is going to be 7, this one going to be 3 L squared. So this one is going to be equal to 3 W L Q over what? Over 24 EI, right? This is 6 minus 4. And then what we have is going to be what? 3 WLQ over 4 EI. This is going to be WLQ over 8 EI. Okay, that is going to be the first part of it. And then the second part of this, what you can use is the 8 kilonewton. So which equation we are going to use? We are going to use basis up on this, up to L. This is downward, don't worry. It's going to be what? It's going to be PL squared over 24 EI. And then it's going to tie 3 times X equal to L. Okay, and then minus L over 2. Okay, and this one is going to be 6L minus L over 6 is going to be 5L over 6. So it's going to be 5PL cubed over 6 times 24, right? 24, 6 times, this is correct. This is 20L minus L over 2. 3 times 2 is 6. 6 minus L. Oh, over 2. Sorry. This is over 2. So this is over 2. This is going to be 5PL cubed over 48 EI. So the delta sub B is going to be equal to, just put it over here, WL cubed over 8 EI, and then plus this is going to be 5PL cubed over 48 EI, and then you put everything together. Okay, just put this one. This one is going to be equal to 6 kilonewton, 6 kilonewton per meter, and then L is going to be 3 meter times 3 meter power 3 divided by 8, and then just keep EI here, okay, and then plus 5 over what, over 48 EI, and the P is going to be 8 kilonewton, and then it's gonna time L cube. I don't think I'm correct. This one gonna be L power 4. This one gonna be L power 4. Okay, this one gonna be L power 4. This one 8 kilonewton, and this one gonna be 3 meter power 3. After you put everything together, you're going to produce the delta sub B by putting this together. It's going to be 83.25 divided by EI with the unit of kilonewton, and this meter divided this one is going to be meter power 3. Okay, and this one is downward. Okay, and next one we move to this one. Okay, you can solve this one. You got to come over here by this one again. We have what? We have x equal to L. We measure to this. So this one again can be used until L. PL square over 6 EI TL minus L. So this is going to be 2L. This is going to be PL power 3 divided by 3 EI. Okay, this is a little bit more simple. And then you don't know the P, okay, the P. Most of the time we put the P equal to 1. Okay, and this time we will have the F sub BB equal to P equal to 1. PL cube over 6 EI, and this one is going to be 1 times 3 meter power 3, and then divided by 6 EI, and you will get this one to be 9, and then meter power 3 divided by oh, this is 27, right? 27 divided by oh, sorry, this is 3. This is 3. Sorry, this is 3, not 6. This is 3. This is 27 divided by 3. This is 9 over EI. And this one is upward. Okay, and then you go further to number 4. Okay, so wing 4 C sub Y. And then we will get this one. C sub Y, so say B sub Y, so for B sub Y. B sub Y is going to be this one. Delta sub B is going to be 33.25, and then divided by EI. And then it's going to be divided by 9. And then this one going to be EI. And then you cut this one, you get B sub Y equal to 9.25 kilonewton. Okay, and then this one is 9.25 is going to be the redundant. You got to come over here. Okay, and then we go to what? Analyze the beam. Okay, we analyze the beam this way. Our beam gonna have what? Our beam gonna be subjected to 9.25 kilonewton. This is going to be 9.25 kilonewton. And then it's subjected to this one is going to be 6 kilonewton per meter. And this one is 8 kilonewton. We're going to find what? We're going to find this one for the A sub Y. This one for the A sub X and this one for the M sub A. Okay. And actually, we going to use what? Summation of X sub X equal to zero. A sub X equal to zero. Very simple, right? And if you the summation of the moment at point A over here, so rotation here is going to be positive. M sub A is here. Okay, it's going to be 9.25. It's going to be 3 meter. So time 3, and then it's going to be 8 times this one 1.5. 8 times 1.5, and then plus this one 6 times 3, and then times 1.5, and then you may get M sub A equal to 11.25 kilonewton meter. Okay, and then the last one, summation of F sub Y equal to zero. This one is upward, A sub Y is up, plus 9.25, and then is equal to 8 plus 6 times 3. Okay, this is going to be the total. This is going to be what? A sub Y is going to be 16.75. A sub Y equal to 16.75 kilonewton. Now, you can draw this one. Okay, you have this one. You finish this one. This one is going to be 16.75 kilonewton. M sub A is going to be 11.25 kilonewton meter. And this one is 9.25 kilonewton. Now, we come here. Let's reset. This one is X meter. And this one is going to be V kilonewton. And the length up here is 0, 1.5, and 3.0. We start by drawing the shear diagram. This is 16.75. Let's put the scale, 10 kilonewton per 10 millimeter. So this is going to be about this 16.75, okay, upward. This is plus 16.75. And then we have the W, the dV by dx is going to be minus 6. So the slope is going to be something like this. So we over here minus this one, 16.75, is going to be equal to what? Equal to the negative of area here equal to minus 6 times 1.5. okay, and then you will get your V is going to be minus 9. Okay, this is 16.75 minus 9. That is going to be 7.75 kilonewton. That is going to be 7.75 millimeter. So you got this, and then we have this one. Okay, and now this is going to be 7.75. And this is 8 kilonewton. 8 kilonewton. That this one down a little bit is minus 8. Has 7.75. It's going to be minus 0.25. Okay, and then the slope, dv by dx is minus 6. And you know, this is going to be 9.25 for sure. This is going to be minus 9.25. For what? For it to be upward and closes. So this is going to be the moment diagram. It's going to be as beautiful as this one. And then later, come into the moment diagram, we have this one for moment kilonewton meter. And then we have this one for X meter. This one 0, 1.5, 3.0. We have what? We have 11.25. This is counterclockwise. So scale, this is 10 kilonewton meter per 10 millimeter. So this one is going to be this one. Okay, let's put this one as minus 11.25. And it's going to be about here. And then what we have over here is slope. The slope here is going to be dm by dx equal to what? Equal to v, equal to 16.75. Okay, and then over here, the slope is going to be 7.75, but the moment here we don't know yet, right? The moment here minus of what? Of minus 11.25. And then this is going to be equal to this area, 1/2 of what? Of 16.75 plus this one, plus 7.75. And then it's gonna have 1.5. Okay. You do the computation of this, the M is going to be plus 7.75 kilonewton meter. So you measure this one is going to be about this one. Okay. And then the slope here is going to be this one. The dm by dx is going to be this one, 7.75. And then the change in slope like this, the curve is going to be something like this. Okay, and this is the point of zero moment, okay? And then this is minus slope. Here is going to be dm by x minus 0.25. And also this one is the roller. The moment here is zero. So by here, okay, we have the dm by dx equal to minus 9.25, and this is zero. So the shape of this is gonna have the curve like this. Okay, this is going to be the moment diagram, and this is zero. And then what we have is the moment here is positive, so it's going to be concave upward. This is going to be concave downward. And then you project this one back into this picture. So we have this one project it back here. This is the point of inflection point. And then what we have, this is fixed, right? So this is fixed. And then this is concave downward. This is going to be concave downward like this. And this is going to be the inflection point. And then this one going to concave upward. You're going to concave this one up like this. Okay, and then theta sub a equal to zero. And delta sub ay equal to delta sub ax equal to zero. Okay, this one, delta sub by equal to delta sub Vx. Actually, this one is very small, equal to zero. And then we have what? We have this one as what? As the theta sub B. It's going to be the tangential point. Okay? And this is going to be the elastic curve. Okay, elastic curve. You got to specify everything. And then you can use this one to reinforce your beam. Okay, by doing this, you can see this one is in tension. Another one is in compression. Most of the beam, most of the time, the reinforcement, okay, always put into something like this. It's on the top and it's on the bottom, okay? And this one, it is put into the column, okay? You may put it something like this. And special thing is what? Is this point, okay? Since this one has what? Has the change in the elastic curve, so the steel may be reinforced here like this, and it needs some development length, okay? Over here also, and this one you may put this steel into this way. Okay, this is going to be the reinforcing pattern, and you're going to put development length here to let the steel, okay, and the concrete bond together perfectly. And this is going to be what we have for this first example. I will have about 10 more minutes. Let me move to the next example. The next example, we will consider the beam bases up on the simply supported beam. Okay, now we are going to analyze this beam. The special thing is this one. This beam has the settlement. Okay, we talking about the beam, the interindividual beam that have the problem with the differential settlement. The first one, we consider the beam, and actually we got the what? We got to let something. If we consider the beam, this is roller, this is roller, this is pin. So we have this is C sub X, C sub Y, B sub Y, and A sub Y. And this is on what we have here. We gonna select the redundant. Okay, let me set what? Let the this time, the B sub Y, this one as the redundant because of what? Because we're going to use this one to solve this problem, okay? Oh, this one is wrong. This is the wrong picture. Sorry, you got to change this one to the one that has the deformation like this. So this is wrong, okay? Sorry for this. Just go back to your lecture, okay? And just select one that's more proper than this. And then you're going to use by using the principle of superposition. We have superposition. We have what the beam is going to be separate this one into this beam, and then plus this one into another beam. This is going to be the same. This is going to be the same bus, the B wood, okay? This is going to be the primary beam. This is going to be the primary beam subjected to the, okay, the uniformly distributed load of 24 kilonewton per meter, okay? And this is going to subjected to this point B, subjected to the load of B sub Y, and then you can use what we have to analyze this one. This beam gonna have the deformation, okay? Deformation, something gonna be something like this. Okay, you got to draw the elastic curve, and this one also have this kind of deformation. Okay, next, we write the compatibility constant, the compatibility condition at support B. So what we have from what? From the elastic curve, of the beams, okay? What we have is what? What we have is this one will at point B. This one will be delta sub B, okay? And this one we call it F sub BB by the unit load and have B sub Y. What we have is what? From the real structure, we have downward is positive, and from this one is going to be 12 millimeter. So since we going to compute it by meter, this is going to be 0.012 meter. Okay, and then it's going to be equal to what? This one downward. Downward is positive, equal to delta sub B, and minus F sub BB and time B sub Y. And then we will get the equation of this, of what? Of B sub Y. Okay, you got to move this one. B sub Y will equal to this one. It's going to be 0.012 minus delta sub B and divided by F sub BB. So this is going to be our equation. So we're going to move to the third step. We're gonna find the force displacement relationship. The force displacement relationship. Okay, and then we start by what? We start by determine the B sub Y supposed to be easier, right? However, for the B sub B, let's say the delta sub B is going to be, we got to move to our PowerPoint, okay? But for this one, you will get this one for 5W, okay, L powerful, and then divided by 768 EI. Let me put it over here. And then this is going to be later 5 and 24 kilonewton per meter. And then the length of it is going to be the total of 8 meter powerful. And then divided by 768 EI. Okay, the unit is going to be kilonewton, and this one is going to be kilonewton and time mass cube, and this one going to be 768 EI, and the top of it is going to be 640 and downward. Okay, and then for this one, you're going to determine this one. For this one, what we have is going to be, this one is going to be the X, okay? The X here is going to be L over 2. So for this one, you just put this one P, okay? And then this is up on this, the load. This is going to be A, and this is going to be B. This is going to be L over 2, and this is going to be L over 2. This is going to be L over 2, and L over 2 PB, and then divided by 6 EI and L, and this is L squared minus L over 2 squared minus L over 2 squared. If you push them all together, this is going to be PL cubed over 48 EI as we has this, okay, before. Okay, I wrote this many times. So this one is going to be F sub B B and P L Q over 48 EI. And then the P is going to be 1. So it's only 1. And L is going to be 8 meter power 3 divided by 48 EI. So you put them together. This one is going to be 10.67 meter power 4 divided by EI. And then number 4, just sub sewing for B sub Y. So our B sub Y is going to be this one going to be in millimeter. So you got to sew it carefully. This is going to be 0.012 minus. And then since there is the EI here, okay, it's going to be a lot more convenient if you just put everything, okay, into the unit. What unit is what? This is going to be 200 gigapascal. This is going to be 210 power 6 kilonewton per square because we use kilonewton in this calculation. And I is going to be 80 10 minus 6 meter power 4. So this is going to be 10.67 divided by 280. Okay. And if you put them together, okay, you may get this for what? 10.67 divided by 200 divided by 80. So this is going to be equal to 123, 0.66688 and 10 minus 3 meter. This is for the F sub BB. So this is going to be 0. Okay. Actually, 66688 and then 10 minus 3. And this one, you just put this one, okay? This one going to be 640 divided by 768 and then 200 and then 80, okay? Just put it together, 640 divided by 768 divided by 200 divided by 80. That is going to be smaller. This is going to be 52.08 10 minus 6 meter. So just put it together, 0.0005208. Okay, and then you will get B sub Y equal to 42.0 kilonewton. So you get this one, okay, as 42 kilonewton. And then you just go to the problem here. Okay, you may draw this one as the free body diagram of this beam, and then this is going to be 24 kilonewton per meter. Now this is going to be A sub Y, this is going to be C sub Y, and this is going to be C sub X. For sure it's going to be 0. And then we have this one for 42 kilonewton, and then you can solve this one for A sub Y and C sub Y, and later you can draw the shear diagram, moment diagram, and then finally you can draw the elastic curve. Okay, I ran out of time for this one, and I give this one to you guys as the example. Okay, and oh, we have to have five more minutes. Okay, five, analyze the beam. If you prefer, just put this one, analyze the beam. Okay, if you for summation of x sub x equal to zero, the c sub x is zero. Okay, if you do the summation of the moment, if you refer about a equal to zero, so the c sub y, okay, will time what c sub y time a, and then you gonna pass what 42. This is 42 will time 4, and then this one gonna be 42, and then the load here is going to be equal to 24 times 4, and then this is going to be 24 times 4, and this is gonna time 2 meters. You supposed to get the c sub y equal to 3.0 kilonewton, and it's going to be upward. Okay, and then the last one, summation of f sub y equal to zero, upward is positive, a sub y plus 42 plus 3, and then it's going to be 24 times 4. Okay, the a sub y going to be the largest one, 51.0 kilonewton upward. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you very much for attending my lecture, and we have about 10 anyway. We are going to have examination today, right? Okay, so see you guys again this evening. Okay, thank you very much, all of you. Bye.